Hillary has been lengthening her excuses as to why she lost the election. She didn't really lose the election. It was stolen from her by, I think it's up to 24 different excuses she has now. Number 24 is content farms in Macedonia. And as I said, my grandfather was a Macedonian content farmer. And we often think about, you know, gathering on the porch and recalling the old days on the Macedonian continent. I never thought, he never thought that the old content farmers he left behind in Macedonia would one day steal the U.S. presidential election. They are gnarled, hardworking Macedonian peasants, and the way they were able to reach out and steal the election.
This thing is recording as well. So, how do we?
And I really have no idea what. I mean, I know everything that happened. I was checking on the news from my Wi-Fi-less. Adobe in Pyrenean Macedonia and then in Aegean Macedonia where I was staying.
and I've been keeping up with the news, but obviously, I mean, August literally is the month where the, at least Europe and America, and probably our friends down in, I don't know about our friends down in Aussie land. If they all go on vacation in August as well, because everything's upside down there. But certainly for Europe and North America, everybody's just gone. And so it seems like it's been slow. But and I'm sure that Zoran Zaev and his government have been grateful for the fact that people have been gone and aren't following the news as much and whatnot. But, you know, Monday, everybody's back to work, at least except for here in the United States where it's a holiday. But in Macedonia, everybody's back from vacation. School starts. People are going to be asking what's going on. How come Boki 13 has been in detention for 43 days and hasn't given a statement, hasn't been grilled by the prosecutor?
They're still negotiating over what he's going to say.
Well, that's the thing. You know, the government obviously doesn't want to get to the bottom of this whole thing, doesn't want to talk to everybody that has been accused or that is involved. And yet at the same time, if it doesn't do that, this thing is just going to kind of drag on like a bad cold. And the European Union certainly wants it solved. Mm. And the European Union is saying, if you don't get this thing cleaned up and pass a new law on the special prosecutor, then we're not going to open up accession talks in October. And even if they do get the law passed and get to the bottom of this, and they're not going to get to the bottom of this by the end of October. They may or may not get a new law passed depending on how much bribing and threats of arrest and intimidation, etc. they do. But then even if all that happens, we've still got the issue. Remember way back when in July? People were talking about the coupling of Macedonia and Albania, and then Edi Rama said, well, if you don't include Albania in the opening of accession talks with Macedonia, then we're going to go out and create greater Albania. He didn't say it in those words, of course, but he threatened it like that's his normal go-to point. So, and we know that the Dutch and the French, maybe the Germans, maybe some others are going to definitely say no to Albania, so... Yeah. This hot mess that is summer will be a hot mess in the fall as well.
Yeah, Albania will want to decouple from us the way things are going. And I think most of the EU countries would be happy to let this one slide for Zaev, like so many other things. They actively encourage him to break the law and abuse democratic rules. I mean, what's another... Oh, okay, this is a major scandal, but what's another scandal on top of everything else he's done? Arrest members of parliament, threaten them to vote this way or the other. But there are several countries in the EU which do not want us to join to open accession talks. And what more could they have asked for than this type of scandal? And the person who was supposed to be the embodiment of the rule of law in the country is seen as hideously corrupt. And, you know, connections from her up toward the government, even better. I mean, if that is determined, and it's easily determined, even better.
Yes, it's that's a great point. She was the quote unquote kind of crown jewel of the Zaev government and their Western elite friends, the special prosecutor's office and the special prosecutor, Katica Janeva, were the crown jewel in this idea of creating an idyllic situation where the rule of law is upheld and corruption is rooted out and there is no more crime and there is a peace, sweetness, and light eternal. I just put out a new column on Medium and it's titled, quote, and it's literally in quotes, best chief prosecutor in the Balkans, unquote. And this was brought to my attention, I guess, just last week somewhere in the Twitter sphere, that she actually received an award in November of 2017 from the International Institute for Middle East and Balkan Studies. And the award is literally, quote, best chief prosecutor in the Balkans. The best office of the prosecutor in the Balkans was awarded to the whole office, the special prosecutor's office in Macedonia. This is not even 2 years ago. And it's kind of funny, Cvetin, because in the press release that the Institute put out, they quote her and she thanks everybody and the staff of the special prosecutor's office and whatnot. But throughout her little statement in this press release, she talks about the rule of law, quote unquote, at least three times. And yet, where is the rule of law in Macedonia today? With not only with the special prosecutor's office, but with the entire government of Zoran Zaev. They have, and it's I think it's useful to remember how we got to this whole place, how we got to this place in the first place. And that is way back, I'm old enough to remember 2015, when Zoran Zaev, you know, then in opposition, started dropping his so-called quote-unquote bombs, the recordings that he received, which, of course, were illegal to begin with. You can't record somebody without their permission. And then he received them illegally. And then he started putting them out in the media, which is illegal. And then then the special prosecutor's office started using them as in their prosecution of individuals, which was illegal. So essentially what they all did, with a wink and a nod from their friends in the Western elites, what they did was they shredded the rule of law to quote-unquote uphold the rule of law. And of course, those two things are incompatible.
Yeah, and they're not desperate to keep this institution running without Janeva, of course, but with Fatima or Lynch or the other prosecutors who are still, they think, are still salvageable. Because, you know, what's Zaev's government without this, without this type of a completely political partisan prosecutorial service, which he still hopes will be able to indict his political opponents and be with the approval of the Western ambassadors here who support his government. I mean, he wants this thing to continue because otherwise even a cursory investigation into Zaev's businesses and his political party and their dealings with Katica Janeva, the extortion of money from businesses through the special prosecutor's office, all of this can bring down the government in a minute. I mean, there is plenty of evidence to indict all of them. And some of the businessmen are talking. Okay, Kamchev is talking through an indirect source, talking to a journalist in Italy, or to somebody who is talking to a journalist in Italy, and then this comes back to Macedonia, but they are talking about what was being done through the special prosecutor's office. It is an active fight between various wings of the Social Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. Apparently, the head of the UBK, the major intelligence service, which is being demolished and then moved into a new UBK directly under Zaev's control, but it still exists. So the head of this service, who is obviously an SDSM appointee, a loyalist, etc., but he was apparently involved in encouraging Urze Kamchev, helping him spring this trap on Boki 13. So, you know, this is an intra-party fight, which is not just going to go away. Many people in the SDSM party are hopeful they can get rid of Shekerinska, maybe even Zaev, but then still preserve the government intact and remain in charge. This is what they're trying to do to themselves. And it's no longer what, even if the Europeans want this to go away, it has a different logic of its own, of an intra-party fight within SDSM.
That's an excellent point. And yeah, especially your last point there, that even if the EU and the various members of the EU and the various governments want this to go away, then they can't control it because it's internal. And it's, I think that's an excellent point to bring up, the fact that it is an intra-party push for power as much as it is a scandal, and it's all intertwined. And who knows how it all relates. I don't know if we're ever going to find that out or not. But again, I want to go back to, you know, kind of what we started talking about. One of the central figures in this whole thing, the tragically flawed Boki 13, has been in detention now for a month and a half. He hasn't said anything, at least publicly, that we know of. I think there have been little drips and drabs, you know, through associates and whatnot. You know, and he's in for another, you know, 20 days or whatever, 20 days. And then are they going to extend it again? Are they going to talk to him? He knows so much. I think maybe the government is also afraid of what he has to say. I hope that, you know, if something were to happen to him, Cvetin, you know, that would, I think then the end of the government would come sooner. And then you mentioned the Western embassies. I thought it was interesting that Mats Staffensen, the Swedish ambassador, finally left yesterday. So he was kind of the last of the, I call him the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Yeah. There was Mats, the Dutch ambassador, Wouter
Plomp, yeah. Wouter Plomp,
yeah, Garrett, Charles Garrett, and then of course our own Jess Bailey, and they're all gone.
And the Italian guy, Balotelli was his name, I think. I think he not so outspoken, but he was presumed to be one of the most important of the ambassadors being involved in this entire show trial or the creation of the political crisis in Macedonia.
Right. But they're all gone now, replaced with others, yep. Or I don't know about the new if the new Dutch ambassador or the Swedish ambassador are there yet.
No, not yet.
But yeah, and of course, you know, and this goes back to points that we've talked about on this podcast and written about individually and together, you know, through the past, that they all are going on, these ambassadors, they're all going to go on to, you know, either bigger and better things, or Jess Bailey, I believe, is retired now. Charles Garrett is in one of the stands.
Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, I keep getting it wrong.
he's probably fomenting another revolution there.
He is.
But they, you know, they get their accolades, they get their praise, they get their checks, and they move on, and they leave Macedonia in a mess. And that's the way. That's the way these services of the State Department and the ministry, the foreign ministries of these various countries work. Is that they all have a singular almost worldview. And it certainly doesn't take into account the sovereignty of the individual nation states in which they happen to be and operate in. I'm kind of going off subject right now, but this is something I'm exploring in my own time. What I call the liberal project, and not big L liberal as in left, but liberal. We're all classical liberals here. But some of the problems within the classical liberal project. But anyway, that's another subject for another time. Back on this scandal, what can we expect in the coming weeks? I know you're just back from some travels, but what do you make out there that is going to happen in the next few weeks, as best you can?
First a side note. Speaking about Garrett, the British Embassy, they're actually now he's now actually promoting stuff in Kyrgyzstan. On rule of law, he's meeting Kyrgyzstanis and talk to them about the importance of fighting corruption in their country, and you know, auditioning for the Kyrgyzstani special prosecutor. And every time he does this, obviously on Twitter, somebody is helpfully informing the Kyrgyzstanis what happened to Boki 13 or Katica Janeva, who are very close to Garrett. He would go to Katica's press conferences. He would meet you know, allowed Boki to disguise, and he would be a guest of honor at his diplomatic receptions, which I once witnessed. It was so bizarre. And you know, they're now washing their hands of the entire mess of the people they elevated to high office, and once they started doing, you know, engaging in crime and abusing their office, knowing that they're untouchable. You know, now one guy is in Pakistan, the other is in Kyrgyzstan, another is retired. David Stevenson is still roaming around the country. Oh, and
that's right, he's still alive.
He's still here, yeah. But, you know, their people are going to prison. And we'll see. I mean, Katica was questioned. It, you know, incredibly took like a month for her handlers to prepare her. She's famously dense, and she had famously trouble reading from a pre-prepared script for a TV interview. And imagine how long it took not only to negotiate with her what she is going to say about her role in the scandal, but also to remember, once the lines were negotiated, to remember them and not to fall into any trap if the prosecutor against her, Vilma Ruskoska, tries something funny, something like a cross-examination. Katica wouldn't be able to stand it for like 2 minutes. She'll keep forgetting the script as was written. So she was questioned after a month, and then after a month after Boki was arrested, and everybody knew from the start that she is going to be eventually charged, but she was allowed to go on vacation with her son. It's still unclear if the son has returned to the country or will try to flee the country, because he's also involved. But, okay, she was arrested. There was this, you know, Shakespearean moment where her mother actually died the day she was arrested.
Yeah,
or the day
that
before,
was bizarre.
Something like that.
Yeah.
She was famously threatening Katica and Fatima, especially Fatima. They were threatening their victims from Vimera, telling them, well, you know, prison is for people as well. So what if you spend 10 years in prison on these stupid charges, politically trumped up charges? Or they were saying this about Gordana Jankulovska, who was pregnant, and they were prosecuting her for 5 things, once stupider than the other, and telling her, well, you know, she can give birth in prison. You know, people have given birth in prison. And then, you know, this was this horrible karmic moment where the person who was saying this, she was then arrested and driven off to her mother's funeral, apparently not even allowed to go to the grave, just to the chapel, and then in Gilead and driven back for back to prison. So Boki still hasn't spoken, which apparently means that he's still negotiating a deal for him. This Kitchets person, you know, Vemer openly said, Christian Mitkovsky openly said that he is the third defendant, that he is being offered a deal that if he, you know, comically involves Mitkovsky somehow in the story, the opposition leader mentions him, that he was somehow involved, even though he has no authority in the situation, could not extort money from businesses. I mean, it's all, everybody on the enabling side and on the executing side was from SDSM or SDSM affiliated. But if somehow one of the defendants involves the opposition in the story, they're hoping that they will be able to buy a few weeks of respite from the horrible political, you know, from the horrible media cycles they're enduring. SDSM is enduring every day now, but that's very, very not very thought true, and still it doesn't change the fact that there are people in SDSM who want to bring down Zaev, and that there are EU member states who want to block the accession talks, and they both have a lot of ammunition to do so at this point.
Yeah, and then one other thing, kind of related to this, but maybe on the side, is, and I think I saw this last week, it looks like finally Nikola Dimitrov, the foreign minister, has finally, he came out last week and basically totally distanced himself from the entire scandal, from Boki 13. I don't know if there's a picture of him with, of Nikola and Boki 13. I don't know if the two of them have actually met. So he's actually been able to keep his nose pretty clean in this whole thing. In terms of that.
No, but his closest confidant, Borjan Jovanovski, was working for Boki 13 inches
that's
television.
True. So. That's true. Yes. Okay. So that's yeah. So if A equals B and B equals C, then A equals C. But again, I you know as I've said for a long time, I think Nikola is looking for a way out. He's trying to get to the finish line, defined as Macedonia actually gets into NATO, and then he's gone. He knows, and he's never been a true citizen person. He's just a he's not Vomero. He's not citizen. He's Nikola Dimitrov. Mm. That's what he stands for.
Deep state.
He's an ND person. So, and that's not New Democracy.
No, I mean he obviously has handlers up above, and they might have some ideas for him. But I mean, listen, if this can still end up as an even greater farce directed by the diplomats here, they might insist on only Katica being arrested, and then you know maybe Zaev is remains in some capacity in the. Remains as prime minister until the end of next year, and that we'll pretend that nothing happened. But
well, except for you mentioned that Boki might be trying to negotiate something, a better deal for himself, which means he's going to squeal and talk about everybody else. Then you got the journalist in Slovenia, Lars Geiser, who has got information from whatever sources. He's putting out stuff here and there. Branko Geroski there in Macedonia, he's probably got more stuff. And I think the thing is, you know, the there have been cracks in the dam, and the water is trickling out, and that just by it's physics, in that the crack will expand and go from a trickle into a flow, because once people start talking, there's just no end to it, and it will just expand as we've seen. And that's just kind of human nature. That's the way it works. It's going to be very hard, I think, for the government to try and shut this up when there's so many different actors involved that are getting information from so many different sources, and it's all getting out there, and people are going to start asking. And again, summer's over. Vacation's over. People are coming back, and people are talking, and... We'll see. I guess it's this ongoing. What did I saw the EU ambassador came out and called it a reality show?
Yeah, she was like dismissing the whole thing. Like, well, it's like a circus. Just compare this to the approach of the diplomats before, when there were much slighter allegations of crimes on the part of Vumero, and they would insist that it's investigated. It's everybody gets arrested, etc. And now they have all this evidence going to the top of the government directly for not only being corrupt and crooked, which we all knew is going to be the issue with them, with Zaev and the people around him, and anybody who just glanced at him would understand what's the problem with Zaev. But they were promising one thing. They wrote in. I mean, Vumero were making promises, but nothing as crazy as this. They were promising economic growth, infrastructure spending, bringing a few manufacturing companies here and there. This was their promise. Zaev's promise was a rule of law, where these lofty yes. ideals of a life for everybody. The young people will come back from abroad. And it's impossible, it's undoable. And on top of this, if they were just incompetent and delivering the promises, fine, but they're actively going against what they promised. They're actively undercutting everything they promised. There were people walking around with T-shirts with the picture of Katica Janeva, and I see them, my neighbors even. You see these people in the morning, and you know, remember they were wearing the T-shirt. And how are they supposed to feel now after they had this? We never promised something like this. We never turned out to be idiots on such a huge, great, enormous promise. We were never betrayed like this by Vumero, by Gruevski. He never made us wear these stupid T-shirts for one thing. And you know, what can you do here?
Yeah. Well, that's kind of that on the T-shirts. That's kind of funny, because that's another thing. I in the column that I just wrote, one of the leaders of the so-called revolutionaries. I won't name him because I don't want to give him any credit. He's a scumbag. But he finally put out a statement the other week after resisting saying anything about the whole affair. And he wanted to try and frame it in a different manner. But he talks about the special prosecutor, and he says that supporting the special prosecutor doesn't mean, quote, adherence to idols, but ideals, unquote. But the problem is that he and the colorful revolutionaries took ideals, which all sound nice on paper and whatnot, they took ideals and they made them into idols, best exemplified, I think, by those T-shirts. And the fawning press coverage and the moniker of Charlie's Angels and the rock star treatment. And so they took ideals, made them into idols, and then they fell down and worshipped them. And then, but of course, as we all know, all idols are false idols.
Yeah, this goes for the EU, for the US, for the diplomats they were praising so much here. And, you know, they were clinging on to every word coming from the embassies. In fact, you know, they created a completely partisan, corrupt prosecutorial service, something similar to what's been happening in the US or in other places. You know, we see elements of this happening in, I don't know, in Italy or in France. Whenever somebody, you know, the powers that be don't like, now this is the preferred method of doing away with the person, with a political movement. Trump up charges, you know, engineer some charges, like Austria as well, and, you know, do away with these people and get back in charge, you know, get the approved politicians back in charge. And this institution could not even maintain some plausible deniability about its own corruption, but is collapsing with the prosecutors accusing each other and people from the SDSM party accusing each other of crimes involving this institution. And now the EU tells us, well, let's we care about the institution, not about the person. The institution is the problem. The institution was completely corrupt from the beginning. Now, Katica is obviously an especially, you know, stupid person. She, the two pieces of evidence which are now being expected to drop. One of them is the fact that, you know, she sent Boki 13 to collect the money. Mm-hmm. And in this glorious moment, reality show moment, as the EU ambassador would say, Boki is offered a pricey designer handbag by Louis Vuitton filled with money. And apparently there was a GPS tracking device inside. So now Kamchev and his handlers, because he also had experienced, you know, professional help from intelligent people, you know, who understand how intelligence works. Mm-hmm. So they now know where the bag was traveling. And there is a lot of rumors that it ended up either in the government building or in the possession of a top Zaev advisor who is listed as his advisor in the government, Zoran Bashanovic, the Serbian, you know, media mogul who was hired by Zaev and who helped Zaev during the Colored Revolution. And then the other moment, you know, a special stupidity by Katica, she's actually not charged about extorting money from Kamchev. She's charged of with extorting, like, furniture for her home, a sofa, I don't know what else, the sofa was mentioned, but for the total price of about 5,000 euros from an expensive, you know, salon for furniture here in Skopje, which is owned by, let me get this straight, by Orce Kamchev's sister's husband.
Oh, wow.
Basically by the sister of Orce Kamchev.
Right.
So she was extorting furniture from him.
Yeah.
And the police, when they arrested Katica, they actually impounded a large sofa from her house. And they were seen putting it in the truck, and now it's presumed that the sofa was bugged. So, you know, imagine how stupid she must have been. I mean, Orce was probably, or his handlers, was probably recording everything she says in her house.
Wow.
Which is, now you can imagine, he can now leak bits of it, he can now negotiate a deal for himself, or just bury them all if he chooses to.
Well, again, that's why this thing isn't going away. I don't think that Zaev is going to be able to cover it up in any way, shape, or form. There's just too many actors, too many players with too much information, who knows what's true, what's false, but eventually the truth is going to come out on all of this, and it's going to bring the government down, in my opinion. It's just a question of when, and more of these people are going to go to jail.
Yeah, that's a given. I mean, that's there's no way, you know, they survive for long. They might try to hang on until December 2020 or October when the elections would be held, but
no way they can do it, especially, yeah. And going back to what we were talking about earlier, is if the EU says no in October, then yeah. You know, this goes back to the whole point of having this group of criminals and clowns in government was to get Macedonia into NATO and at least to a starting point for the EU. And the NATO thing is going to work. The EU thing isn't. But again, this goes back to what I've been saying and writing about for a long time. I think you've said and written the same thing, and that is that the whole point of the name change was to get Macedonia into NATO. And the name change, one of the main drivers behind it was the United States State Department and the NATO diplomats. And I'm very careful about how I choose my words here. I don't want to say America or the Americans, because it's not. It's always a very small group of people. And it's these Western elites with this particular worldview. And so they wanted Macedonia in NATO, and the reasons for that we won't get into now. But they don't really care about the European Union. And so once they've achieved their goal with NATO, EU matters much, much less. But Zaev made his promise to the Macedonian people of getting Macedonia in NATO and at least to a start point with the EU talks. And that is in jeopardy now. And even if the EU were to say, yes, we'll open up accession talks in October, we both know, the Macedonian people know, it's at least 10 years, and the EU is going to fundamentally change between now and 10 years from now because of a whole host of reasons.
Yeah, and, you know, from a purely political perspective, you know, for Zaev, it would actually be good to accept the Vimera proposal to have elections in April, even after, you know, by then we lose out on EU accession talks but gain NATO accession, because the damage to his party will not be so great if he's now intending to hold out until October or December, and if he does so...
Of next year.
I mean, again... 2020, yeah, right. And... Everything happens next year. Vimera demands April 2020. Zaev says October 2020. The regular deadline for elections is December 2020. And, you know, by then the damage would be much bigger, given that we now have his own UBK security chief apparently being involved in the scandal, which is directly aimed uncovering the scandal, which is aimed directly at Zaev and at Shekerinska. So, you know, the damage can only get greater for him, and he can only lose the elections by an even wider margin if he persists in delaying the elections. This is not a good position for him.
Right. And then to kind of go off on a slightly different tangent, but still... very much at the heart of all that we're talking about. We talk about damage. The damage to Macedonia's name and identity. Again, the reason that we're even talking about all this right now is because Zaev is the quote-unquote prime minister and in government, and was put in power because certain Western elites wanted Macedonia, NATO, etc. But it involved a name change against the consent of the governed. The Macedonian people said, no, we don't want to change. Yes, we want in NATO. Yes, we want in the European Union. But we don't want to change our name. We don't want to change our identity, our faith, our culture, our heritage, our history. And yet that is what is going on even as we speak, even as we talk about this scandal. The pressures on the Macedonian people in terms of their identity continue day by day, bit by bit, drip by drip. There's a interesting article I just found yesterday. It's a Kiwi article from New Zealand, and it's about Macedonia and Kosovo, although they call it, quote-unquote, North Macedonia. Interesting paragraph here. It says, quote, travelers can now tie themselves in knots deciding which of the two, meaning Macedonia and Kosovo, which of the two is the newest country in Europe. Is it Kosovo, which declared independence in 2008, or North Macedonia, which technically has only existed since its February 2019 name change? And I've seen this, and Svetin, you know, I monitor the media daily, and I've seen articles like this before in which people are asking, so Macedonia is a new country, or they call it North Macedonia. And the Macedonians are actually North Macedonians. And I maintain a list of links to media and other outlets that actually refer to the North Macedonians, the North Macedonian people, the North Macedonian government, the North Macedonian monetary system, North Macedonian airspace. I mean, and this is the long-term damage. And then we're not even talking about what Bulgaria and Greece are doing to Macedonia's educational curriculum. We know that the committees, the respective committees between Macedonia, Bulgaria, and Macedonia, and Greece are meeting, which doesn't get a whole lot of news coverage these days, but they're meeting talking about changing the curriculum and the changing the school books, the textbooks, the maps, the atlases that Macedonian children study from. We saw, oh, here's another thing that we haven't even, you know, and I know this, we're playing catch-up right now because it's been a while since we've recorded this, and we should mention that this is the Macedonian Content Farmers Podcast, episode 38, I believe. But we haven't even mentioned the other week the government put those plaques on the statue on the Plostad in Skopje, on the quote-unquote warrior on a horse, saying that this represents Hellenic heritage and Macedonia has nothing to do with it and blah, blah, blah. And of course, those plaques, which is kind of funny, they're very, very small, and they were put on the base of the fountain there, and they were immediately removed. I guess replaced. I don't know. I'm sure the Greeks are monitoring whether or not that's taken place. But and then, of course, the removal of the star of Kutlash from throughout all Macedonian public space, which creates a backlash, of course. I think more and more people in Macedonia are using the flag with the original flag of Macedonia with the star of Kutlash and using that symbol, you know, all over the place. And of course you're going to have a backlash when you ban it and are trying to persecute people for using a symbol that is found throughout Macedonia. Dug up on items in the ground, it's on cultural artifacts and churches and other places around the country. And now you're telling people that you have nothing to do with that, even though it's been on your territory for thousands of years?
Yeah, it was our first episode. We were joking about how eventually the government will have to scrape off the Star of Kutlush from the manhole covers.
Oh my goodness, and is that what we said in episode one?
Yeah, it's the title of the episode.
I have to go back and listen to that.
It's the title of the episode, and now we are back to... It's actually, like a Bad Simpsons episode, it actually became true by episode 40. Before we got to episode 40, it became true.
Oh, in less than a year. I think we just came up with the title of this episode.
And I was just in Aegean Macedonia, as it's now officially called, I suppose, or South Macedonia, and they still have it. They use it. They would put it. They're even promoting some TV station Macedonia now there, and I mean, I once wrote a joking article how it would, you know, this insistence on the part of Greeks to build up an identity for Greeks as Macedonians. It will, you know, in a country which faces these chronic bankruptcies and unsustainable debt and constantly debates whether to finally begin printing at least a regional currency as its peg to the euro is unsustainable. This can lead one day, one lovely day in the future, in an actual secession of Greek Macedonia from the rest of Greece, now that they have built up an identity and have a capital and have most of the electricity in the country and sufficient coastline and port and oil refinery and everything. It couldn't actually happen if they insist on building this identity. It's not for nothing that Greece was banning the use of the word Macedonian and the identity Macedonian, and you know, and was banning the development of a Macedonian identity in its north because it feared secession, and it might turn out to be for for a pretty good reason. We had the PAOK, which is the Solun, the Thessaloniki-based club, football club, playing Ajax from the Netherlands, and they had this sign saying Macedonia is one, and it is Greek. And if you check out the origins of PAOK, they started like as a club of Greeks expelled mm-hmm. from Turkey. So they've been living in Greece for less than 100 years, but they are the ones who have the hard on for the Macedonian identity and the symbols and the history of Alexander. And they're, you know, theirs is a tragic story just as ours is. But, you know, if we're looking into actual lineage and ties to the land, they have very little of it. But, you know, it's a big mess. It's a big, confusing mess. It's caused a reaction in Greece with the elections, and it's going to cause, as you said, a reaction in Macedonia. That's unavoidable.
Yeah, well, and we see on at least, especially on social media and especially on Twitter, how the Greeks are, you know, trying to take over hashtag Macedonia. It's kind of funny because if you look at the handles of the Greeks that do tweet, the trolls basically is what they are. They have very few followers. It's actually quite sad and pathetic what they're attempting to do, but that's okay. You know, we just ignore them, and we just keep talking about the beauties of Macedonia. As a matter of fact, I have seen a number of on the flip side, I've seen a number of foreigners, friends of Macedonia, that are tweeting about Macedonia, tweeting things like there's one couple, I think they're Macedonian Polish or something like that, but they're tweeting out places in videos and pictures of Macedonia saying you can't find this in Greece, only in Macedonia, which is fantastic. So all right,
no, this is just there's going to be a response from both sides. There's going to be a growing response from both sides, and then we join NATO, but this thing is going to continue to fester, and especially if we don't open new accession talks, the resentment will grow, and ultimately we'll have a very unhappy and unsatisfied new NATO member country, and very likely, as soon as again Greece faces another of its downturns, a very unhappy and unsatisfied old EU and NATO member. You know, truth be told, the French, the Dutch have the right idea. We do not belong in the EU. None of this should have happened. They should have said so before. They should have pulled the plug much sooner. But okay, now we are in for a pound. And we'll see what happens.
Exactly. Well, so I don't have a farmer's pick this week. That's fine. This is kind of a catch-up. Next week, we'll get back into the swing of things. No farmer's pick, but I alluded just a moment ago to that couple. It's Audrey and Harry. I guess they're American Polish, and they go under the handle the BS Travelers, and they're the ones who say you can't find this in Greece, you can only find this in Macedonia, with a lot of beautiful pictures and videos from all over Macedonia. And so this is my point on the that you're seeing more people, especially just friends of Macedonia, coming out and promoting Macedonia, simply because the Greeks are trying to, even on the Twitter sphere, trying to deny Macedonia and the Macedonian identity and Macedonian history and everything else. So,
yeah, dziękuję pani for the promotion of the country, and yeah, you're right. This is just going to get broader and involve more and more people. I mean, that's especially once we get some international clout in NATO, and obviously after a government change in Macedonia, it's going to be a fine mess.
Yes, fine. That's oh dear, I'm gonna have to go back and look it up. That's a Laurel and Hardy reference, I think.
It's
a fine mess you've gotten us into. All right. Well, this has been a good recap, catch up. Welcome back. We'll do a formal Macedonian Farmers Podcast, Macedonian Content Farmers Podcast. See, I've already forgotten what we're called.
Yeah, a European-style vacation does the tour
bring. Exactly. So, anyway, welcome back. Great to catch up with you.
Sure. Take care, buddy, and take care to everybody listening there.
Thanks. You too. Fine romance, you won't even wrestle. I might as well play bridge with my old maid aunts. I haven't got a chance. This is a fine romance. Fine romance with no kisses. A fine